Tonight on Access TV, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with the best of season one, part two, The Wrath of Calm. With your host, Ryan Stout. Gotham Comedy Live's best of season one is all happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Ryan Stout.
Welcome to the best of Gotham Comedy Live, Wrath of Calm. We've been lucky to have so many comedians perform at Gotham Comedy Club, and tonight we'll show you some of our favorite moments from season one. Coming up are some of the best hosts we've had here on Gotham Comedy Live.
With Chris Brown, punched Rihanna. It was sad, y'all, okay? But it wasn't surprising. Everybody in here know black dudes who can sing and dance named Brown will smack the shit out of you. We know this. We got decades of data on the subject. James Brown, Bobby Brown, Chris Brown. How much more evidence do you need? He can sing and dance. His last name is coming. Sad. And then Christmas, they get back together. I was like, all you want for Christmas is your two front teeth? This ain't the way to keep them, bitch. Listen to me.
I wonder what noise I'll make when I die. No, it's a weird question, but I hope I die. I hope I make a man noise. I hope I die like a hero. I don't want to die like, you can make a bitchy, you could do that. I was thinking about that. I was reading about gray whites, and they're 3,000 pounds, 4,000 pounds, and they hit you at 25 miles an hour. I don't care who you are. That's what's gonna happen. That's the noise. And then you just disappear, and two pieces of poo float to the surface. I'm terrified of sharks. I'm not dying. I don't wanna die by biting, so I'm not gonna go in the water. That's why I don't. I live right near the beach in California, but I stay here, and the people, I'll let them float over there. And you see, it's like, oh, it's rare, it's very rare. Yeah, where you're floating is rare. Where I'm standing is never, okay? You live in rare land, I'll live in never, never land. How's that sound, huh? So annoying, just punch him in the nose. I don't know if you know that, but if a shark comes at you, you're supposed to punch it in the nose. I've been hearing that since I was a little kid. I always took it for granted. I had a surfer tell me that. He's like, bro, if they come at you, you just hit them in the nose. Oh, it's a Chevy with fins, but okay. Punch it in. So, not to be, seriously, I thought about that. Like, I practice punching underwater just to be ready. You know how hard I punch underwater, huh? I can't even punch straight, my fist goes up. It's so fresh, like a 3,000 pound gray white, 25 miles an hour. Ow, my nose!
We just did things a lot different than most American families, all right? We had a garden in the back. Dad had a beautiful garden, tomatoes, cucumber, string beans, right? You could go shopping in my backyard, right? But we had a problem. There was a raccoon. Something was coming and eating my father's tomatoes. Now, most American families, they handle that, you know, they're like, well, just call animal services. They'll set up a trap. And then they'll release the animal back into the wild. My father's like, listen, we're gonna murder this motherfucker.
So I brought some cuties to throw in the audience. Now, these aren't tangerines. They're a smaller version of tangerines. I know there's a lot of guys out there. They probably are thinking, I wish I had a tangerine, but really, I've got a cutie, you know? So I'm gonna throw them to those guys right now. Come on, be careful, what's happening? Look at that! How did you know it must be like that guy caught it? Hey, that's not for you, lady. And then here's one for the Indian guy. Come on, this doesn't make sense for the stereotype, but who cares? What happened? Is it still on the rafters? It's okay, we have a regular cleaning crew and then a monkey cleaning crew swings.
So it took me a long time, and I married a guy who had four teenagers. I know, I'm a brave woman. And when I first met them, I didn't know how to deal with them. So basically, I bought their love, is what I did. And it worked, because I would meet them, I would see them for the weekends, and, you know, they were all athletic, and I'm not athletic at all, and they'd be like, let's go kayaking, let's go skiing, you know, let's go camping. I don't camp. If God wanted me to camp, she wouldn't have invented the Ritz-Carlton, all right? So I would say, you know, let's do something I'm good at, let's go shopping, and they followed me like I was a Pied fucking Piper. And my mother used to say to me, you know, you can't buy their love. No, you can. They're like Russian mail order brides. So now I got these kids and I got these teenage girls I'm responsible for. And, you know, I worry they're having sex, and nobody wants to believe their daughters are having sex. And then they get flowers from the New York Knicks.
I really hate thin people, make me sick. I do, I hate thin guys. I hope you get hit by a donut truck. That's my fantasy. After the show, you're like, it was a good show, and you're like flexing in a window, and it fucking hits you. And because of your awesome chest, it steps and flips over, and donuts fly into my mouth. And I step over your gorgeous dead body. But I wouldn't even have to lift my leg up, so you're so thin, I could just walk over regular.
I keep hearing that we're a fat country, but then I go home late at night, and I see these ads on TV saying just the opposite. You know, it's like, bleeding heart liberal. One in four Americans goes to bed hungry every night. Why? Stop off at the fridge on the way to the bedroom, shithead. I just solved that problem. You go to bed hungry in a country where, you know, on a windy day you can hit in the chest with a slice of pizza by accident, for Christ's sake. I just saw a pigeon eating a half a cheeseburger. Step on his neck and take it. You're bigger than he is. What the fuck? What are you, idiot?
The cabs, I'm so impatient in a cab. I am like Faye Dunaway in the back of a cab. I'm like, I told you to go up 6th Avenue and across 44th Street. Why do you defy me? Drive, go around the bus, go around the bus, drive.
So, tell them why we're not a comedy team.
So we're not a comedy team. You know, you can tell by our timing. Because a great comedy team needs a straight man, and we don't have one. He's a fag, I'm a faggot. I do call you a fag a lot. I call you a fag all the time. And I don't mean it in that kind of like cool guy sleeping with guy way. I mean it in the pejorative sense.
First of all, pejorative, nobody knows what the fuck that means, okay?
Gay guys do.
No, I don't. I mean, no, they don't.
Dumbledore is gay, did you guys hear that? J.K. Rowling, author of the Harry Potter series, sent out a press release saying that the character Dumbledore is gay. Some people were outraged, couldn't believe it. I can't believe he's gay. I'm like, really, can't believe he's gay? But you could believe he's a wizard? Interesting. I'm pretty sure gay people actually exist.
Get yourself an iPad. It's the greatest invention in the history of mankind. It is. I can prove it. My son is 4. He sits on long flights, hours, and he draws puzzles. I mean, it is so beautiful. He is so quiet and such an angel that sometimes I think I love this thing so much, I would dig Steve Jobs up and I'd suck his dick. 4-year-old keeps quiet for 6 hours. He sits there, he draws puzzles, and he watches movies, and he falls asleep, and you can take it to the bathroom and jerk off. You find me something that's better. Yeah, they got Wi-Fi on these planes now, guys. You didn't think I'd put two and two together, Delta? Occupied. Still occupied. What do you think's happening in here?
I think it's funny that we've only had one black president in the history of this nation, just one. And as soon as he became president, they downgraded our credit. We used to have perfect credit. and the black dude ruined our credit. It's like the rest of the world was like, they have a black president, they will not pay.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV with the best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live's The Best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. More laughs right now.
Welcome back. People love sports. I personally don't watch sports because it's really just entertainment in the form of a power struggle, and I get that from reading poetry. But for most people, sports allow them to escape the tragedy of their lives. Yes, for a few fleeting moments, you can forget your worries as you sit in the stands and enjoy a game while a smelly, chest-painted hooligan is spitting all over your face and screaming in your ear about how his team's gonna win and the other team's gonna lose. Fun time. Nevertheless, here's what our comedians have to say about the wide, wide world of sports.
I try to stay in shape. I play sports. Love sports. The only sport I don't like is soccer. They don't call it that in Europe. What do they call it? That's right. In Europe, they call soccer football. In America, we call soccer fucking boring. I got yelled at by a French guy. He goes, you Americans don't like soccer because you've never won a World Cup. Well, that's true. America's never won a World Cup. But then again, we did win two World Wars. So what's up, bitches?
I do old guy things now. Like, I currently play in an over 40 men's softball league. Yeah, this is true. 9 out of 12 guys on our team have injuries. But none of them are from the game. Can you imagine how pathetic it would sound if they tried to broadcast it on television? Like, Jim, I don't know if you heard, Joe Matarese, the left center fielder, is going to be out for about 6 weeks. He blew out his ACL stepping over a baby gate at 2 a.m. Pete Stromsky, the first baseman, is going to be out for a long time. I think about 11 weeks. He tore his ACL trying to put a Pottery Barn desk up into his third-story attic. Man, I don't know if this group's going to make it through that long 8-game season. I don't know.
USA's men's Olympic basketball team kicked the shit out of the world. Did you see the French when they saw us coming? The French were like, holy shit, the niggas are coming, run. Hide the women. Did you see the English? The English are like, well, no one told us they could fly. Is that legal? Are they allowed to do that? I thought you had to dribble, perhaps pass it, then maybe take, there he goes again. Look at that, just. With their dicks in our faces, this isn't good.
So I get in the cab about, what was it, 2 or 3 weeks ago here in New York City. His big thing was he was talking about football, American football. He'd seen 2 football games, and he didn't understand it. So imagine watching a football game for the first time, not knowing the rules or anything. He's like, I don't get it. I don't like that game. I don't get it. I'm like, what don't you get? He goes, I don't get it. I don't like it. I go, well, tell me, what don't you get? He goes, okay, this is what I see. And he starts to explain American football. He goes, this is what I see. I see a bunch of big, huge guys, right? Standing around in a circle, looking at each other, going, what do you want to do? I don't know. What do you want to do? I don't know. What do you want to do? Then these guys come up with this big secret plan. Right? And then these big, huge guys, they walk up slowly, make 2 big lines, and then one guy takes the ball and runs right into the pile. I'm like, that's the best you could come up with? That was your big secret plan? Then they slowly walk back to the circle, look at each other and go, okay, that didn't work, what do you want to do?
And what they did to the Nigerians was just wrong. Beat them by 86 points. Poor Nigerians, they had no clue. They were running in the wrong direction. Passing the ball to the USA team. Arguing amongst themselves. Why did you pass the ball to him? Because from this angle, he looks a lot like you, okay?
All I saw was his nose. So in my mind, I am thinking this has to be Umakwekwe. So I pass it. And to both of our surprise, it was Kobe, okay? With his dick in our face.
I'll leave you guys with this. I'm a big sports fan, but what I really don't like is how the media tears down athletes, right? They tear down athletes. Johnny Manziel, right? Johnny Football, guy wins Heisman, first freshman ever. They're like, Johnny, we saw you with a bottle of champagne. Is this a downward spiral, Johnny? Olympic gold medalist Michael Phelps, 22 medals, most decorated athlete, 18 gold. Michael. That horrible marijuana incident, Michael. Are you better? Are you better? We saw you drinking a beer at a Ravens game. This kid swims like a fucking dolphin, okay? 18 gold medals. Let me tell you something. If I won one bronze medal at the Special Olympics, you'd see pictures of me blowing cocaine with midgets.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV with the best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live's The Best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. More laughs right now.
And we're back. You know, finding a special someone is always difficult, usually because you're an elitist television host who is always way too picky and impossible to please. And even when you do meet a seemingly perfect girl, you eventually find out she has a flaw or two, and you think, I could do better. I can find a girl who doesn't poop. Well, let's check in with our comedians to see what they have to say about the single life.
When you a single dude, your self-esteem gotta be high as shit, because no follows you everywhere you go, okay? When you a single dude, no is your constant companion. Just try to meet somebody. Hey, girl, no, all right. What's up, girl? No, okay, why are you yelling, no? There's no reason to yell. Just say no, I'm right here. You know how hard that is, ladies? You know how hard it is for a brother just to walk across that floor at a club and ask you to dance? You know, because we got to build ourselves up, right? Because we usually trying to come back off of a previous no. So we be trying to build ourselves up. We be on the other side of the club like, fuck it, I'm going to go ask her. Fuck it, I'm going. That's what we say when we get to that point. Fuck it. And then we look at our boys, we be like, yo, you think I should go? And our boys be like, yeah. Because they know what's going to happen. And dudes are evil, too. They'll gas it up like, yo, she's been checking you out the whole fucking night. I don't know what you waited for. Then we build ourselves up and we walk over there. We usually got to go through the crowd. Excuse me, I'm trying to... So everybody see you going over there, right? And we usually dancing when we ask you, what's up, girl? And women are cold-blooded, baby. They will make eye contact. Absolutely not. But you can't stop dancing because you're already committed. Now you just feel like an asshole. And here's why it's messed up when you're a dude, right? There's no support group. Okay, you think them same friends that told me all that bullshit to help me go over there, you think they're waiting on the other side of the club with a drink and a hug? No. No, they over there laughing their ass off. Because that's what we do to them. That's what men do to each other. You see your boy get shot down, you be like, oh, shit. Right? And you bring people into it. He don't even know. Look, 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 look. That's my boy. That's my boy right there. No, no, I know you don't know me. But that's my dude. He's a fucking asshole.
Online dating is brutal. Girls, I want to know your hobbies. What are your hobbies? I don't know. I guess I like lurking on this site. G- Girls, stop putting up pictures with you and your friends, by the way. So confusing.
I'm on the left.
Yeah, well, who's the one on the right? I recently reached my creepy boiling point, though. I was dating a 23-year-old. Turns out I am closer to her mom's age than her age, which did not turn me on as much as I thought it was going to. She was complaining about her mom. I wanted to be like, oh, moms. But I was like, oh, I actually agree with her. This is gonna sound weird, but go to your room.
I'm at that age. You guys recommend marriage, huh? I feel like that's my choice in life. Either stay single or get married. Single, married, single, married, single. Either I sign for a lonely existence, jerking off to porn every night, or I stay single.
Look at the married man. Oh, I don't get that joke, honey. Oh. Well, I don't know what even. No, I better clear my Google history when I get home.
It's all about survival now, right? Because everything's bad for us. We can't enjoy anything anymore. Anybody here remember casual sex? Remember casual sex? 20, 30 years ago, you go out to a nice club like this, meet a perfect stranger, go home, make love, wake up in the morning and feel good about yourself. Not anymore. Woo! Nowadays, you sleep with a stranger on Monday, you dead on Tuesday. You got to be careful. That's why it's very important, fellas, sleeping around casually, make sure you bring your own condom to the table. Why? Because women buy condoms there. Mm-hmm. And they will embarrass you with the ones that they pick out. See, they laughing. They know where the hell I'm going with this shit right here. Now, women tend to set their expectations a tad bit too high. Well, I'm gonna make love to the one girl. She pulled out one of these Magnum condoms. You ever see the Magnum condom? Come in a gold case? Shit, I thought it was a new iPod. I don't know what the hell that damn thing was. I opened that thing up, I swear to God, a hefty bag fell out that thing. Man, I put that thing on, I had my penis, my balls, everything was inside there. I damn near had my butt cheeks in it. I was like, this is ridiculous. Is this much air supposed to be in here? I said, we gonna make love or go to bed. I'm wrapped up in a sleeping bag over here. Some of y'all are laughing, the rest of the white women here looking at my crotch like, oh my God, what happened to hell? He didn't get one.
I am a single guy. I'm in the coveted demographic of the mid-40s, non-gay, never married man. Ooh. We're quite a crew. Yeah. Yeah, clap now. Where are you on Match.com? That's what I want to know. Yeah, we're like the commandos of creepy. It's like, hey, we're the weirdos on the dating scene. The psychopaths. We're the kind of guys who put the harm in eHarmony. And I don't know what this move is, but it's not helping. It's true. I actually had someone ask me this. They said, what's it like to still be alone while everyone else is paired up? Huh. Oh, I don't know. It's like standing in the rain watching Noah's Ark pull away. Well, looks like it's just me and you, unicorn. We have to make this work.
I don't know, man. I had a girl, and we broke up. Oh, you like that? Well, she broke up. I'm still with her. It ain't gonna be that easy. Thinking about stalking her, too. Can't really stalk. You know why? Because I got ADD. It is hard to stalk someone when you have ADD. Like, I followed her three blocks before I had to call her. Did you make a left or a right on Main Street? You know you got a tail light up? She moved out. She didn't even tell me she was moving out. So when I came home, I thought we had been robbed. Like, I was walking around like, we've been robbed. But they only took her stuff. She gonna be pissed. Yeah. She wanted to be married, though, right? She said I was procrastinating. But here's my question, though, ladies. If you want to be married so much, why not just ask the man? You look how quiet it got in here. They're like, oh, we ain't gonna ask for that. You ask for everything else. I say, look, change that tradition, ladies. Get down on one knee. Pop the question. What's the worst thing that can happen? You say no. If you say no, then get down on both knees. Come on, where you at, fellas? Where you at, fellas?
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV with the best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live's The Best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. More laughs right now.
We're back with the best of Gotham Comedy Live. Our last set of comedians shared some of the hardships of being single, but just as bad, being married. See, no one's ever happy. Marriage is obviously difficult. Think about it. You've lived your whole life as an individual, and now you have a legally binding contract attaching you to another person for as long as you both shall live. Ugh, every activity in your life becomes a three-legged race. It's a constant struggle. So here's our next group of comedians talking about being hitched.
I think marriage is basically just finding someone who you can tolerate. Just someone you can put up with. Which is why they use the word take in the marriage ceremony. It's like, can you take this one as your wife? Really, you can take this one? All right, you do what you want to do. But I'm getting irritated just looking at you.
Married 17 years about 2 months ago. Don't clap! You don't know what I'm going through, don't clap. I love her, I just don't understand. I have no more patience either, that's the difference. Married 17 years, my married folks know, especially the men, it's the first thing that goes is the patience. Oh, we just run out of it. I can't wait anymore. I can't do the wait. You know the wait when you're already dressed and she's in the room? See, when you're single, you can't say shit. When you're single, you just gotta sit there. Take your time. So you're married, you have no more patience. You're like, hurry the fuck up! Fucking leave you! And women do this shit, we don't know. Women come out of the room and put on a fashion show that nobody paid to see. Every woman does this shit, they come out in the outfit, baby! Stupid crowd, why look late? Bitch, you look late.
No, why not? We've been there 12 years, and it's great. We're still learning a lot about each other. Like, I found out a couple of years ago that my wife grinds her teeth at night. And I found this out because some of you know what I'm talking about. She wears a mouth guard to bed. I had no idea. We were together 10 years at that point. I had no idea she even owned this thing. One night, she just throws in this mouthpiece. We're getting in bed. She goes, you want to have sex? I'm like, no, do you want to play hockey? What the hell's in your mouth? You a goalie? What is that? Can I grind my teeth? I have to wear my mouth guard. How angry are you in the middle of the night that you're like... I make fun of her, though. I have my own sleep disorder. I have sleep apnea, which means you like stop breathing in the middle of the night and almost die. I just tell them, you know, just every night, I just have a dream that someone's choked me to death and I'm just like... My wife's over there going, My buddy's a doctor. He goes, dude, you got to get this mask. You got to wear this mask to bed. I go, I'd rather die than wear a mask to bed at night. Can you imagine that? Imagine that sex, by the way. My wife's wearing a mouth guard, and I'm dressed up like Bane from Batman. My wife's like, you want to have sex? I'm like,
yes. Yes, I do want to have sex. Turn around.
My husband is a comic book nerd, but very good looking. And that is a great combination, right? Low self-esteem, but attractive. So this is what happened. I walked into the room and he slammed down his laptop, right? Slammed down and then went like this, hi! Is there anything more guilty than that? I was like, what are you looking at? He was like, nothing, vacation options. And he is a smart guy, but I know he is not smart enough to clear his browser. So the next day when he is not there, but his laptop is there, I open it up and I've got my finger on the touchpad because I am going to find out what porn this guy is looking at. But I froze because I was like, do I really want to know this? I know, and I know he, for sure he's not looking at pictures of girls that look like me, right? Like, he's not buying Jewy brunettes with upper thigh issues. God. I'm his wife. He's looking at the opposite of me, right? He's looking at big, blonde, busty Christians who can't get enough. Because he knows I can get enough. But who can stop themselves from an answer that is one click away? No one. So I brought up the last website he had viewed, and I started reading it, and I was like, what the fuck is this? Because it was a website called MuggleCast. That is a website for Harry Potter enthusiasts. That is what that is.
She went to a holiday party, bought a new outfit, new dress, shoes. She bought the dress in October. She said, I'm gonna work out and I'm gonna fit into this dress. She didn't really work out that way. She bought the size. That's about four sizes too small. And that women don't marry. I swear, when you're married, you can't. She want to get me involved in the putting on of this dress. I don't want to be a part of this shit. No man wants to hear this. Honey, help me zip this. I'm looking at the zipper like. And the zipper is looking at me like this.
I just feel like my gay friends are a little too excited. Because every time I talk to them, they're like, we want gay marriage. I'm like, really? Have you talked to married people? Yeah. They're not a cheerful bunch. I don't want to be a party pooper, but there's no married people parade. We've all seen the gay pride parade. Looks like a good time, right? Floats, music, people waving rainbow flags. Woo-hoo. Can you imagine a married people parade? Oh. Men and women in bathrobes shuffling along. Put on Law and Order. Put on Law and Order.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV with the best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live's the best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. More laughs right now.
Welcome back to the best of Gotham Comedy Live. It's time to talk about how French people smell funny, Mexicans are lazy, the English have bad teeth, the Chinese are bad drivers, black people steal, the Japanese have small penises, and white people are the devil. That's right, it's time to talk about stereotypes. You didn't actually think I meant any of those horrible prejudice things, did you? I was simply introducing the next topic. And before you go making assumptions, the answer is no. This piece of media propaganda wasn't paid for by the money-grubbing Jews. Racist.
Little kids can't be racist. I was in third grade. I was in an all-Italian, all-white neighborhood. We moved to Florida. It was mixed. I noticed something very quickly. Black kids are much, much faster than the white kids. One being racist just noticed it. So I asked my black friends, why are black guys so much faster than white guys? You know what he said? Something very racist, but he was messing with me. He said, we have special muscles that help us. And I was 10, so I was like, I want special muscles. Can I get some? He's like, you can't have them. I'm like, well, I'm Italian. What do we have? He's like, pizza. I'm like, I don't want pizza. I want special muscles. He's like, you can't have them. I'm like, well, then you can't have pizza, dude. He's like, I'll eat pizza anytime I want. I'm like, if I see you eating pizza, I'm gonna smack it out of your hand. He's like, if I'm eating pizza and I see you coming, I'm gonna run away. And you won't be able to catch me because I have special muscles that help me. Then I was just like, I'll yell that you stole the pizza and then the cops will beat you and you'll get 7 years in jail. Because you know what beats your special muscles? The American justice system.
I met this woman named her daughter Paige May. I'm like, Paige May, that's different. Where'd you get that name? She said, well, I was in the department store And I was in a sleepwear area, and I saw her name spelled out for me. P-A-J-A-M-A.
Right. And I said, pajama? After I said it, she realized, I was like, oh my God! That poor little girl, for the rest of her life, she's gonna be like,
no, it's pajama. No, you're saying it wrong. Pajama.
First day of school, okay, roll call, Jenkins. Pajama.
Happy holidays, guys. Let me just say this. Black people, I will concede that Jesus is black if you concede that Santa is white. Have you ever seen a kid of any race get sent to a non-white Santa? I have. It was a black mom sending her black child to a half-black, half-Chinese Santa. And she was like, go sit on Santa's lap. And the kid looked at the mom like, I need to fucking talk to the real Santa. Okay? He's not being racist. He just wants the right guy to get his gift order, right? He's like, I need the fat white motherfucker from the North Pole, not this bootleg Wu-Tang Santa that you're trying to fucking set me up with, right? Oh, bootleg Wu-Tang.
It's really awesome because we got a mixed crowd here. You guys can get the word out. Let's get it right. We've been getting it wrong, but let's get it right, okay? I'm here to tell you, look at me. You see who I am up here on the stage. White people, if you're here tonight, white people, in fact, dance better than everybody else, including black people, yes. Not a lot of buy-in on this concept. All the non-white people were looking at me like suspicious, right? Even the white people, you guys are confused right now, you know? You're looking at me like, no, Dwayne, actually, I don't think that's accurate, what you just... Well, I will explain it, and it's gonna make sense. Here's why white people dance better. When white people dance, we know it to be true. White people, you have more fun than everybody else. Right, especially if you got one or two, fun. Like, I've seen white people dancing, and I'm like, how do I get that? You know what I mean? Like, I've actually never had that much fun. I don't know what that is. And why do white people have so much fun? I broke it down, two reasons. One, I think it's just a pure celebration of your whiteness. Woo, I'm white. Hashtag winning. And the second reason why white people have so much fun, you have so much fun, white people, because when you dance, you have a freedom that I don't have. You're very free, yeah, yeah. And why are you so free? Well, because you're not married to the beat, I guess is the thing I'm trying to... You're not gonna let the beat tell you what to do. And that's freedom. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because that means it doesn't matter what song is playing. You can do any dance. I don't have that luxury. I got to do what the song tells me to do. And trust me, every black person in here, we've all tried it at home. We've all tried it. Every last one, I promise you, we've all tried it at home. Can't do it. We can't do it. We've all been home making fun of white people. You know what I'm saying? And we've all tried to dance off beat, and we can't. Because, see, what happens is we get back on beat by mistake, is what, by mistake.
Funny thing, man, up here, I learned something racist the other day. It was kind of funny, but, like, don't get white guilty on me. Just listen. Like, I just learned, you know, if a white dude can beatbox, it's miraculous. But if a black dude can beatbox, it's genetic. True story, I'm in New York. Dude, I went up against, his name was Tyler Boards. I'll never forget Tyler had the cool, spiky hair, right? Had Ugg boots on, had a necklace made of shark teeth, right? Got on the mic, was like, hey guys, I'm Tyler. I've been practicing some sounds with my lips. Just tell me what you think about it. Got on the mic. Boom chicka. Boom chicka, boom, boom chicka.
boom, chickity boom, 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 a chicka boom, splash. Boom, chicka. Whole crowd was like, oh my God. He's so talented. He's like Justin Timberlake. He's amazing. He must have went to some fancy school and studied the drum set with his mouth in order to do what he just did, right? I get on stage, feel better. Like, I came on talking shit like, yo, what's up? It's Derek Gaines. We taking the city back, right? Came out, yeah, like turkey bacon. Let's go, right? I started doing stuff. I got on the mic, was like. Take the bass out. See, it's funny that y'all clap and laugh because the crowd that night was like, well, that's what your big lips are for.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV with the best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live's The Best of Season 1, Part 2, The Wrath of Khom. More laughs right now.
Well, we're nearing the end of The Best of Gotham Comedy Live. For our final segment, we've put together some of our favorite jokes that don't fall under any specific category at all. Or maybe we just got too lazy to find a category that would include all of these bits. Either way, here's an assortment of some of our favorite random material from Season 1 of Gotham Comedy Live.
I like to joke right after sex. For me, I think that's a good time for some jokes. And he would always get mad at me. Like, I like to pretend like the guy tricked me into it. That's very funny to me. I like to pretend like it's like the olden days and I'm just a real moron. And the moment sex is done, I like to be like, well, I don't understand what this had to do with the children getting their cure for polio. Oh, you promised. You said if we did all those terrible things, those children wouldn't have to die. It was all a lie, wasn't it? And now look at me, just laying here all covered in sin. I feel like the right guy is gonna be like, hey, sugar tits, all those children, they never had a fucking chance, all right? They're in a pile right now, just mangled with polio. Now clean yourself up, for Christ's sake.
So when I get bummed out, I go to KFC, I get the family picnic bucket. And I eat it all day until it's gone. That's all I do for the whole day. I take the day off with the bucket. So I go to KFC recently, I'm feeling like shit. I walk in, it sucks immediately, because as soon as you walk up and go, I'd like the family picnic bucket. The guy gives you a look like, you don't have a girlfriend, do you? Because it's 10 pieces, two large sides, four biscuits. That's what it is. So I order it and I go, for my two sides, I'd like mashed potatoes with gravy and coleslaw, please. And you know what? Keep the biscuits. I don't eat them. And he goes, well, do you want another large side then? That's what he said. And I said, don't fuck with me right now. I'm in a dark place. And he goes, no, I'm not fucking with you, man. You gotta get something for that biscuit money. Which, that sounds like something a pimp would say. So he goes, get another large side. So I'm like, Jesus, this is getting a little ridiculous here. Give me the green beans. Let's add some health into the mix here. Which, if you ever had the green beans at KFC, worthless. Zero nutritional. They're green straws in water. That's all it is. So he goes, no problem, coming right up. He walks away, he comes right back. He goes, dude, listen, man, we're out of extra crispy. Do you mind waiting 10 minutes? I gotta make some more. I say, no problem. Mistake. mistake for a number of reasons, which you'll find out. But the first mistake is you don't want time to sit in KFC. You just don't. You don't want time to contemplate what it is you're about to do to yourself, all right? But I agree to wait, so now I'm sitting in KFC, and I got that same feeling I have when I'm drunk and I go to a massage parlor, you know? Should I be doing this right now? This is terrible. What am I doing? This is terrible. Oh, I'm up? Okay, great. Thank you. Awesome. Thank you. He comes out after a few minutes. He goes, "Hey, man. Hey, buddy, you want a soda? It's on me." And I go, "Why?" And he goes, "Because I feel bad that you're waiting here, man." I go, "Dude, are you not? I was going to drink nothing but water to offset this sodium avalanche that's about to come into my body. An IV of Gatorade couldn't compensate for the rock salt in chicken form I'm about to eat. Now you want to bring sugar into the mix? Are you out of your fucking mind?" Yeah, I'll take one. Fuck it, I'm here.
The gay pride parade. Before you die, you gotta check out the New York gay pride parade. First of all, there are more straight people than gay people at that parade. They should call it the look look parade. If me and my friends go, we're like, psst, look look. They're kissing. And you all know exactly what I'm talking about. When you're someplace and you can't point the traditional, "Hey, look at them," with the finger, right? You gotta get in the corner, keep perfectly still, and point with all your energy. Look at her, look over there. Sometimes you gotta point a little harder. Over there, over there! And with all that, you always get that one idiot. "Where? Look over where? I don't see nothing. Why keep whispering?
Anybody here have a fart, then walk away, and then watch other people as they walk through the fart? Have you ever done that, people? That is hilarious! Especially if you catch somebody with their mouth open. Oh, you don't ruin their entire afternoon.
A few more minutes goes by, then he goes, "Hey, buddy, you're up. I got you." So I walk to the counter, and I do the checklist as he loads the bag. I watch him load the bag. You gotta do the checklist, man. Because do you ever order fast food, and you get home, and they forgot something? Like, you want to murder somebody when that happens. You're all excited. You're like, "Yeah, I'm gonna eat my shit, cocksucker!" So, I watch him load the bag. I'm like, "Chicken, check. Mashed potatoes, check. Coleslaw, check. Green beans, check." Then he goes, "Hey, buddy, we're gonna give you some potato wedges. Sorry again about that wait." "Stop it!" Puts potato wedges in, then he puts the box of biscuits into the bag too. He gave me the biscuits and the biscuit money. I'm like, "Fuck, man, I don't want those biscuits. But I have sulking to do. I don't have time to argue with this guy right now." I'm like, fuck it, I gotta go. So I take this shit home. I skip home with my food. I get home, sweatpants go on. Yeah. There will be nappings in between the feedings. And I lay this shit out all over my coffee table. And I start getting down. Down. I'm eating with an apostrophe. All right? I'm like, "Chicken, blah, coleslaw, mashed potatoes, potato wedges, taking them, dipping them into the mashed potatoes." Yeah. Look, I call that a speedball, okay? Green beans, get the fuck out of here. What was I thinking? And I put a dent in the shit, and I'm full. I'm full, like. And just as my eyes are rolling back into my head, I have a thought. I think I will have a biscuit. Why not? We're here. I lean forward, I pick up the unopened box of biscuits. I'm like, this feels heavier than biscuits. What's going on? I open it up, more chicken! He gave me 5 extra pieces of chicken! That's how fucking sorry this guy felt for me! And he didn't even tell me about it! It was his way of flirting with me quietly from a distance. As if he was taking a picture of his pussy and emailing it to me while I was at work. Like, I know what you like, big boy.
But what do strippers always say the reason they're doing it for? Why?
College.
Yeah, college. I'm gonna be a lawyer. This is just short term, right? Stripper came up to me and my boy, swear to God, and she goes, listen, just want you to know I'm putting myself through med school and be a doctor. Wouldn't it be some shit if like 20 years down the line, you went in for open heart surgery? And a doctor walked in, and he was like, oh, snap, Diamond? Shit, you weren't.
We've reached our conclusion, but don't worry. We have many more great comedians coming to Gotham, so stay tuned, because with a live, uncensored show, anything can happen. Until then, see you next time.